right, everybody, and welcome to the very first episode of the Honky Tonk History Podcast. I'm Joey Alcorn, and this podcasting thing is brand new to me, so bear with me as I learn the ins and outs of how all this stuff works, how all this gear works. I'm used to having a guitar in front of me and being on stage and singing in front of people, but recording these sort of things, I guess it's kind of like going back to the old days and doing radio in a way, so we'll just kind of think of it that way, as if this is some old school kind of radio show. But anyway, the Honky Tonk History thing is something new I'm trying out this year, and we'll see how it goes. But, you know, for almost 20 years now, I've been going around and talking to these folks that played with Hank Williams, Ernest Tubb, Lefty Frizzell, all these traditional country music people who are my heroes, and a lot of your heroes, too. And it's been a lot of fun for me, and it's something that that I've really enjoyed about being a musician, is getting to work with the people that work with my heroes. So some of these episodes will feature interviews with people like that. Some of them we're just going to dive into specific topics, like this one, which is going to focus on the Lovesick Blues and Hank Williams' first appearance on the Grand Ole Opry. So let's go back 70 years to the night of June 10th, 1949, when Hank Williams arrived in Nashville on the eve of his Opry performance. Nashville was not yet what we think of as Music City, USA. Commercial recording had only started there about 4 years earlier, and Acuff Rose was the only publishing company in town. And Lower Broadway wasn't yet the neon light barroom circus that it is today. Those buildings were all just banks and department stores and just sort of regular everyday things in the 1940s. It was also 45 years before the AT&T building, also affectionately known as the Batman building, would come to define the Nashville skyline. At this time, the 12-floor Stallman building in downtown, which housed radio station WKDF, was the tallest building in town. So that should give you some sort of idea just how long ago this really was. But the one thing Nashville did have was the Grand Ole Opry. In its 24th year of broadcasting on station WSM at that time, the Opry was the most popular country music program in the country. Over the course of those years, it had built a loyal following with stars like Roy Acuff, Red Foley, Bill Monroe, Eddie Arnold, and Ernest Tubb. All that success also made the Opry very resistant to change. Electric instruments were not allowed on stage until 1943, when Ernest Tubb came along with an electric guitar in his band, and in 1944 they even went as far as trying to make Bob Wills' drummer perform from behind the curtains. But change was on the way, not only to the Opry but to Nashville and country music as a whole, in the form of a lanky 25-year-old from South Alabama who had the number one song on the country charts with something called Lovesick Blues. It wasn't a blues song, it wasn't even a country song, it wasn't anything like the popular music of that time. In fact, the song was a 27-year-old vaudeville tune that everyone thought was a horrible song, with the exception of Hank Williams. So let's take a look at where this song came from, how it made Hank Williams a superstar, and altered the course of country music forever. And to do that, we gotta go back to New York City in 1922. Lovesick Blues, or I've Got the Lovesick Blues as it was originally entitled, was written by Irving Mills and Cliff Friend, copyrighted in 1922, with Mills authoring the lyrics and Friend composing the music. Friend was born in Cincinnati, Ohio in 1893. He was encouraged to move to New York City by vaudeville actor Al Jolson, where he became a writer with Tin Pan Alley, a collective of songwriters that dominated popular American music at the turn of the century. Aside from Lovesick Blues, I'm sure pretty much everyone is familiar with this piece of music. Yeah. That piece of music is called Merry Go Round Broke Down. It was written by Cliff Friend in 1937 and would achieve popularity as the Looney Tunes theme song. So now, if you're anything like me, every time you hear Lovesick Blues, you're going to think about Bugs Bunny, which is weird, but it is what it is. Irving Mills, the other co-writer, was born in Odessa, Ukraine in 1894. His family immigrated to the United States, where he grew up in a Jewish ghetto on the Lower East Side of New York City. His exposure to popular music started early. He found work as a page in a theater district restaurant that had a fine orchestra, and soon after landed a job at New York's world-famous Friars Club, where he met some of the biggest names in show business at that time. From there, he got hired into a vaudeville theater in the neighborhood of Tin Pan Alley, where all the music publishers resided. His singing ability got recognized and landed him a job as a song plugger, promoting the songs of a music publishing house. In 1911, he married and moved to Philadelphia, where he found work with music publisher Leo Feist. Together with his brother Jack Mills, who was working for another music publisher in Philadelphia, the two formed Jack Mills Music, Inc. in July of 1919. And according to Cliff Friend, the origins of Lovesick Blues goes back to the war to end all wars. He said, quote, "I was a fighter pilot in the First World War at Wright Field in Dayton, Ohio. I was impressed by the lovesick boys who left their young wives and sweethearts for the service. I had been writing songs since I was 12, so I wrote Lovesick Blues," end quote. And that's kind of a weird way of putting it, I guess. Like, what does being 12 years old have to do with writing Lovesick Blues? Is he implying that it was a very simple song or something? I'm not sure, but in any regards, Irving Mills completed the lyrics for a 1922 musical that was entitled O Ernest or Ooh Ernest, depending on what spelling you can find online. We tried to do some research on this play or musical or whatever it was to try to find out something about it, but there's literally nothing about it. It must have been so bad that there was nothing written about it, there was no press about it, and it's pretty much been forgotten to history. The only thing we know is that it was about these World War I soldiers, their girlfriends, and the fact Lovesick Blues was written for it is the only reason anyone even knows it existed today. The song was first performed on stage in this musical by an actress named Anna Chandler. There are no known recordings of her performing the song. The first commercial recording of the song was recorded by Elsie Clark on March 21, 1922. I have never heard nor have I been able to find a copy of this version. Later that year, it was recorded by Jack Shea for the Vocalion label, who was an Al Jolson sound-alike. The song fell to Shea after Jolson had rejected it. This version is very bizarre. When I've played it for people, I always tell them it sounds like an outtake from The Wizard of Oz or something. So take a listen and see what you think. This is the 1922 Jack Shea recording of Lovesick Blues, the oldest known recording of the song.
But she don't give a darn about me. To make her love me, I tried. How I sighed and I cried. But she just refused. And ever since she's gone away, I've got those lovesick blues. Got the feeling all the blues. Since the sweetie said goodbye, seems I don't know what to do. All I do is sit and cry. That last long day we spent alone, why I'm yearning for it yet. They she thrill me with a kind of loving I never will forget. The way she called me sweet daddy was just a beautiful dream. I hate to think that it's all over. I lost my heart in sea. I got so used to her somehow, but I'm nobody's baby now. She is awful when you're lonesome and get the lovesick blues. I went to the doctor, asked him what's the matter. He looked at me and said, why, your spinal okatoka is badly bent.
and your urethra breaker has been strained. You have Rav-Dav for guidance, and Poop-Up to kite us, and Killy-Loo McNitus of the brain. Your Diaflipatuka is very, very bad, and your little heart is torn apart. You've got the lovesick blues, the only thing to do is to get yourself a new sweetheart. I've got the feeling called the blues. Since the sweetie said goodbye, seems I don't know what to do. All I do is sit and cry. That last long day we spent alone, why I'm yearning for it yet. They should thrill me, fill me with a kind of loving I never will forget. The way she called me sweet daddy was just a beautiful dream. I hate to think that it's all over. I lost my heart, it seems. I got so used to her somehow, but I'm nobody's baby now. She is awful when you're lonesome, and yet the blondie blues.
And so there you have the Jack Shea version of Lovesick Blues. It's pretty weird. It's got that weird narration breakdown kind of thing in the middle with all sorts of weird medical terms or whatever he's talking about in there. I'm really not sure, but that just has the classic vaudeville sound, what you would expect from that time. But still, the song never made any waves. It failed to chart. It didn't really impress anybody. And it was another version of the song that flopped. There was another version of Lovesick Blues recorded around this time by a guy named Cliff Edwards, who was also known as Ukulele Ike. Like the others, his version failed to chart or make any sort of impression on listeners, so it was just another failure for Lovesick Blues as far as being a commercially successful song. But Edwards would actually prove to be an important piece of the puzzle in getting the song back into the studio yet again. Cliff Edwards was a well-known performer on the Al G. Fields minstrel vaudeville circuit in the early 1920s on one of the most important tour circuits, or whatever they called them at that time, something known as the Keith Circuit. It was on this tour where he met and worked with Emmett Miller, a blackface minstrel performer originally from Macon, Georgia, who was born on February 2nd, 1900. It's believed by historians that Edwards actually helped Miller obtain a recording contract in October of 1924 for OK Records. Some of these songs that Miller recorded for OK Records would go on to be big hits for other stars in the future, such as a song called Any Time that would be a massive hit for Eddie Arnold some 25 years later.
Before I go, now any time that you want long. Any time that you wobble do, oh Lord, now any time.
Right or Wrong, which would go on to become one of Bob Wills' signature songs after he released it in 1937.
No matter how I try, right or wrong, I'll always love you. Through you gone, I can't forget.
And another one made popular by Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys, one called I Ain't Got Nobody and Nobody Cares for Me.
Oh,
on September 1st of 1925, OK Records sent record producer and field recorder extraordinaire Ralph Peer to Asheville, North Carolina. And yes, that's the same Ralph Peer that just 2 years later would record the Carter Family and Jimmy Rogers in Bristol. Now, it's also worth noting that Jimmy Rogers was in Asheville, North Carolina at this same time, and it's entirely possible that him and Emmett Miller crossed paths at some point. Jimmy Rogers had a short-lived radio show on a brand new station there, and there's some speculation that Emmett Miller may have been one of the artists that appeared on this show. I don't know if there's any evidence to back that up. I've read it, but it's certainly interesting, and maybe that's something we can dig into a little more if we ever do one of these on Emmett Miller or Jimmy Rogers. But at this Ralph Pierce session is where the first Emmett Miller version of Lovesick Blues comes from. He was backed only by a pianist named Walter Rothrock, and this primitive field recording displayed all the qualities that would make Miller a star during his day. As described by Nick Toshes in his book Where Dead Voices Gather, quote, "His wry, bizarre phrasing, his eccentric timing, his startling falsetto flights in the middle of vowels, his uncanny swoons of timbre and pitch, these were only the most accessible elements of the singular essence that set him apart in his own day and forever," end quote. And of course, what's interesting to me about that quote is you could almost say the same thing about most of Jimmy Rogers' recordings. But anyway, let's take a listen to this version of Lovesick Blues. This is the first Emmett Miller version, recorded by Ralph Peer on September 1st, 1925 in Asheville, North Carolina. That version was released the following month, backed with Big Bad Bill Is Sweet William Now as the B-side. And like every version before it, it failed to make any waves. Nobody really seemed interested in it, and it didn't seem to have any potential. But for some reason, Miller decided to record the song again on June 12, 1928 in New York City. I would guess that he continued to perform the song live after recording it in 1925, and maybe it got a good enough reception that he thought it was worth another shot. This time it was recorded with his new backup group, the Georgia Crackers, a band that included future legendary jazz musicians Tommy Dorsey, Jimmy Dorsey, Gene Krupa, and Eddie Lang. Miller also started this recording off with one of his minstrel routines. Maybe he thought this would help him sell more records, I'm not sure, but he really seemed invested in trying to make this song a hit. But it was never meant to be a hit for Miller. This version was released in July of 1928.
I'm in love with a beautiful gal. That's what's the matter with me. I'm in love with a beautiful gal, but she don't care about me. To make her love me, I tried, Lord, I was sad and I cried, but she just refused. And ever since my mama's gone away, I've got them lovesick blues. I've got a feeling called a blues since my mama said goodbye. It seems I don't know what to do, do, do. All I do is sit and cry. Lord, the last long day we spent alone, I'm yearning for her again. She's filled me with a kind of loving. I never will forget the way she called me sweet daddy. It was just a beautiful dream. I hate to think it's all over. I lost my heart in sea. Oh, Lord, I got so used to her somehow. But I know my heart is like a papa now. It's awful when you're lonesome. You got them lovesick blues. Oh, Lord.
And just like all the other versions of Lovesick Blues up until this point, it was another flop. The public just really wasn't into this song at that time. It had been around for 5 or 6 years at this point and had been recorded at least that many times, but none of them found any sort of success. There was a song called Lovesick Blues recorded in 1927 by a blues singer named Bertha Chippy Hill. It had no similarities with the Cliff Friend Irving Mills version. The only thing interesting about this version is that it features a performance from a very young Louis Armstrong. Speaking of Cliff Friend and Irving Mills, at some point in the 1930s, Cliff Friend bought out Irving Mills and Jack Mills Music Incorporated and renamed the company Mills Music Incorporated. But as far as Lovesick Blues goes, the song wouldn't surface again until a decade later in 1939.
I got a feeling called the blues, oh Lord, since my baby said goodbye. Lord, I don't know what to do, now all I do is sit and sigh. Oh Lord, that last long day she said goodbye. Lord, I thought I would cry. She'll do me, she'll do you, she's got the kind of loving. Lord, I like to hear when she calls me sweet daddy. And it's such a beautiful dream. I hate to think it all over. I've lost my heart, it seems. I've grown so used to you somehow. I'm nobody's cracker daddy now. It's over and I'm lonesome. I got the lovesick blues. I'm in love with a beautiful gal. That's what's the matter with me. I'm in love with a beautiful gal. But she don't care about me. I tried and I tried to keep her satisfied, but she just wouldn't do.
Now I feel so lonesome, I got them lovesick blues. I got a feeling called the blues. Oh Lord, since my baby said goodbye, Lord, I don't know what to do. All I do is sit and sigh. Oh Lord, that last long day she said goodbye, Lord, I thought I would cry. She'll do me, she'll do you, she's got the kind of lovin' Lord, I like to hear when she calls me sweet daddy. It is such a beautiful dream, I hate to think it all over. I've lost my heart, it seems. Oh Lord, I've grown so used to you, baby, somehow I'm nobody's cracker daddy. Now it's over and I'm lonesome, I got the lovesick blues. Oh Lord.
And that's the Rex Griffin version of Lovesick Blues from 1939 that was released on Decca Records. Rex Griffin was a country singer from Gadsden, Alabama, who was heavily influenced by Jimmy Rogers. He's probably best known for his biggest hit, The Last Letter, which was released in 1937. His version of Lovesick Blues was recorded on September 25th, 1939 in New York City. Griffin essentially copied Emmett Miller's version vocally and lyrically, the only difference being that Griffin was the first to make the chorus into a verse and the verse into a chorus. By this time, Cliff Friend and Irving Mills had long been forgotten as the writers of Lovesick Blues, and Decca actually released the Rex Griffin version of the record without even putting a songwriter on the album. It is believed that Rex Griffin thought the song to be public domain himself, or even claimed he wrote it. Nobody's really sure, but either way, that's what he told fellow honky-tonker and Alabama native Hank Williams when he sold him the song for $100 sometime in the mid-1940s. According to Griffin's manager, Hank and Rex Griffin played shows together around Birmingham and North Alabama, and it was at one of these shows where the transaction more than likely took place. Members of Hank Williams' Drifting Cowboys band at this time would recall Hank performing the song at shows, but it never got the acclaim or excitement from audiences the way it would in the very near future. Artie Norred, Hank's steel player in the 1940s, told me that Hank would play Lovesick Blues solo acoustic at the end of a set because he never had a band together long enough with the same guys for everyone to know all the chord changes. So had you gone to a Hank Williams show in the 1940s in Alabama, you might have heard him perform Lovesick Blues, but it would have been a version that was very similar to the Rex Griffin version. It wasn't until he moved to Shreveport in 1949 and joined the Louisiana Hayride that Lovesick Blues started to build a head of steam that would launch Hank Williams and the song to national stardom. In July of 1949, Hank and Audrey made the move from Montgomery, Alabama to Shreveport, Louisiana. Fred Rose, Hank's producer and publisher, had secured him a one-year contract with radio station KWKH and the Louisiana Hayride. Tillman Franks, who was the booking agent for the Hayride, remembered the first time Hank performed Lovesick Blues on the program. He said, quote, "The first time Hank did Lovesick Blues on the Hayride, he didn't even have a band. I was on the bass, we were rehearsing at KWKH, and Hank was playing it in F. Then there was a part where it went from F to B minor or something like that, and I said, 'Hank, that one chord you got in there, I can't figure it out.' Hank looked at me and said, 'Don't worry about it, Hoss, just stomp your foot and grin.'" Within a few months, Hank had worked Lovesick Blues into his set and was performing it regularly. This time, the response he was getting to the song was phenomenal, so naturally he wanted to record it and release it on MGM Records. He recorded a demo of the song with Boots Harris on steel guitar and Smokey Paul on electric guitar and sent it to Fred Rose. Fred Rose was not impressed. He wrote back to Hank and told him he wanted absolutely nothing to do with recording the song. His next recording session was scheduled for December 22, 1948, at Herzog Studios in Cincinnati, Ohio. A recording band had been in effect since January 1 of 1948, so this would be Hank's first session in over a year. Hank and Audrey made the drive up to Cincinnati with Clyde Baum, who was the mandolin player for Johnny and Jack on the Hayride. The songs he brought to record for the session were Lost on the River, There'll Be No Teardrops Tonight, I Heard My Mother Praying for Me, and Lovesick Blues. According to most accounts, Fred Rose was not happy at all with Hank's selections. Two hymns, one original song, and a 27-year-old vaudeville show tune. It's not hard to imagine Rose's frustration with Hank on this session. Not only had he shown up wanting to record a song that Fred Rose had already rejected, it was also the first session that Audrey wanted to record a duet with Hank. The first three songs went well thanks to some top-flight Nashville studio musicians that had recently quit Red Foley's band and moved to Cincinnati. The band featured Zeke Turner on electric guitar, Lewis Innes provided a second rhythm guitar, the legendary Jerry Bird on steel guitar, the aforementioned Clyde Baum on mandolin, Tommy Jackson on fiddle, and a local radio announcer and DJ Willie Thal on bass. With the first three songs in the can, it was time to take on Lovesick Blues with little time left in the studio. Some have suggested that Fred Rose slow played the recording of the first three songs in hopes that there wouldn't be enough time to even get a take on Lovesick. Perhaps hoping that the song would just go away, but that's sort of hard to believe because at this time sessions were set up to where there were 3-hour blocks and you would cut four songs and that was enough to release two albums, two A-sides, two B-sides. So if Fred Rose was trying to pull off something like that, it really doesn't make a lot of sense from his perspective because he was just looking to get out two records on Hank before the next session rolled around. Jerry Bird would later recall Fred Rose glaring as hard as he could at Hank Williams from the control room and saying that Lovesick Blues was the worst damn song he had ever heard. Zeke Turner would also claim that Fred Rose wanted no part of the song, insisting that it didn't have a pattern, it was out of meter, and it didn't end anywhere. Clyde Baum would later recall Hank and Fred Rose getting into a pretty heated argument over the song. "I'll tell you one damn thing," Hank said to Rose. "You may not like the song, but when it gets so hot that I walk off stage and I throw my hat back on the stage and the hat gets encores, that's pretty hot. And you said that Pan American was no good and it sold pretty well." After this back and forth went on for a while, Fred Rose told Hank to do whatever he wanted, that he wanted nothing to do with recording the song and he was going down the street for a cup of coffee. Before he left, he told the musicians, whose fees would be deducted from Hank's future royalties, that he would pay them time and a half if they were done before the 3 hours of studio time was up. As Fred Rose was walking out the door, Hank yelled to him, "You're mighty damn free with my money." With less than a half hour of time left on the session, Hank took the song from his guitar case and ran through its complicated chord changes and odd structure for the musicians. Zeke Turner and Jerry Bird recycled a lick that they had used with Ernest Tubb on a recording of Waiting for a Train a year earlier that mimicked Jimmy Rogers' yodel as the intro. After cutting two different takes of the song, Jerry Bird told Hank that it was the sorriest thing he had ever heard and asked him, "You ain't really going to release that, are you, Hank?" Seemingly unable to convince anyone of the song's potential, Hank replied, "Well, maybe we'll put it on a flip side or something." After the session, Hank returned to Shreveport and his regular radio show on KWKH and his Saturday night appearances on the Louisiana Hayride. He told fellow performer Johnny Bond in January of 1949 that, "I've got a song I just recorded called Lovesick Blues, and if it doesn't chart, I'm going to quit and go back home to Montgomery." MGM released Lovesick Blues backed with a reissue of Never Again Will I Knock on Your Door on February 11th, 1949. The single sold 50,000 copies in the first 2 weeks. Billboard magazine reviewed the song in its February 26th issue, giving it an 85 rating and praising Hank's razzmatazz approach and ear-catching yodel. Back in Shreveport, the local newspaper celebrated Hank's success with a story that said, Lovesick Blues ranks 11th in this week's Billboard poll of most played jukebox folk records. This is a nationwide survey conducted by the Amusement Journal. In this section of the country, it probably tops the list. The three record distribution centers that serve the KWKH listening area, New Orleans, Dallas, and Houston, report total sales of more than 35,000 copies of Lovesick Blues in just 3 weeks' time. So if the record sold about 50,000 copies in the first 2 weeks, and from this story we can assume that 35,000 of those were just in the New Orleans, Dallas, Houston area, it really goes to show how popular Hank Williams was in that region at the time. Noticing the traction that Lovesick Blues was getting for Hank Williams, it inspired a flurry of artists recording their own version of the song, which was common at that time. Among the first to get in on the action was Decca, and in March they reached back into their vaults and re-released Rex Griffin's The Last Letter, backed with his version of Lovesick Blues on Corral Records, their new subsidiary label established in 1948. By mid-March, Hank's recording of Lovesick Blues was in the national top 10, and by April 2nd it had ascended to the number 3 spot, facing tough competition from Eddie Arnold's Don't Rob Another Man's Castle and George Morgan's Candy Kisses. Acuff Rose Publishing took out an ad in that week's Billboard magazine quoting Tulsa, Oklahoma DJ Bill Taylor as saying Lovesick Blues was the greatest string record in years. And needless to say, Fred Rose was shocked, but maybe not as shocked as when a lawsuit was filed against Acuff Rose by Mills Music Incorporated, suing the publisher for copyright infringement. It's difficult to say exactly when they knew there would be an issue regarding who owned the rights to the song. When Acuff Rose submitted writer and publisher information in January of 1949, it read Composer Rex Griffin, Arrangement Hank Williams, Publisher Acuff Rose. When the actual records were pressed up, the composer credit was left blank. So that leads you to believe at some point between the song actually being recorded and the records being pressed up, they knew there was going to be an issue. The Shreveport Times newspaper even ran an article entitled Lovesick Blues About to Be Released. In the article, they claimed the authorship of the song is much disputed and under investigation, so it was no secret that something was going on with this song. Now, this is where we're going to get into the weeds as far as what really happened, who said what, this person said this, this person said that. So I'm just going to present the evidence that's out there, and you can kind of come to your own conclusion as to what you think happened. Hank had told Fred Rose that the song was written by Rex Griffin, and that he had bought it from him, and as far as Hank knew, maybe that was true. He was aware of the Emmett Miller version, though. In a letter from Wesley Rose, Fred's son, to Hank Williams at KWKH, dated March 28, 1949, Rose wrote the following to Hank, seeking his help in clearing up the issue. Just got back from New York, and I have a hint regarding publisher on Lovesick Blues unless we can prove this tune is public domain. You mentioned that you have an old Decca record by Rex Griffin and also an old record by Emmett something or other on this tune. Please mail me those at once. So this letter verifies that Hank Williams owned and undoubtedly had heard at least these two versions of the song. It also proves that he was well aware that Griffin didn't write it, because the 1928 Emmett Miller record clearly lists Miller and Friend as the composers of the song. There was also an interview that Hank did with a magazine called National Hillbilly News at the end of 1949. In this interview, he mentioned Emmett Miller's record, and he claimed that he had been performing the song for years, but still gave no indication of where he first heard it. Rex Griffin would later confide in Lum York, one of Hank's longtime bass players in the 1940s that would have been in Hank's band at the time they would have been performing shows with Griffin, that he wanted to sue Hank Williams over what he thought was an infringement of his arrangement of a public domain song. It really makes you wonder if any of these guys knew where the song had actually originated. But Hank Williams was aware of the Emmett Miller recording, which begs the question, did Hank knowingly lie about who wrote the song in fear of Fred Rose not allowing him to record it, since Acuff Rose would not stand to gain any money from the publishing rights? And from Hank's perspective, this makes sense. He knew he had a hit song, he knew he had a song that could get him to the national stage, But Fred Rose was already against recording the song to begin with, and if they weren't going to make any money off the publishing, that's two strikes against it. So I could see Hank kind of going along with that and trying to get the song recorded, and maybe he thought no one would show up to claim ownership. Another scenario to consider would be that Fred Rose, who spent some time in the Tin Pan Alley publishing world early in his career, knew Hank didn't write the song but didn't expect the record to sell like it did and thus not attract any attention, allowing Acuff Rose to claim the publishing on it without anyone noticing. But when it became a hit, Fred would have known they had a problem soon after the record was released and started selling like it did. And this theory actually makes a lot of sense when you take into account the way the publishing paperwork was handled and there being no writer listed on the record's label when it was manufactured. And to throw even more uncertainty and mystery into this thing, when I started researching for this project, I was completely under the impression that Fred Rose was against Hank Williams recording this song, as has been written in nearly every biography, every interview that's been done to date. But on page 84 from the Snapshots of the Lost Highway book, there's a copy of this letter from Fred Rose to Hank Williams. It reads, "Hank, check for $100 expense money to Cincinnati is being mailed today, but be sure to keep an expense account so I can turn it in to MGM for reimbursement. Be sure you know the enclosed song good when you get to the session for the back of Lovesick Blues, and I think Nelson King will go all out on a plug. Blue it up as much as you can, and if you can better the melody, go ahead and do it as I wrote it quick. Get into Cincinnati early Wednesday. If you do not come through Nashville, as I'll probably rewrite a little of the tunes for you and Audrey. Regards, Fred Rose." So this certainly raises a lot of questions that have never been asked before. If Fred Rose was corresponding with Hank Williams and had the intentions of putting There'll Be No Teardrops Tonight on the flip side of Lovesick Blues, I've never heard that before. And it certainly changes the historical background of Lovesick Blues and Fred Rose and Hank Williams. But I'll let you come to your own conclusions as to the answer for that, because honestly, your guess is as good as mine. Whatever the case may be, the issue was ultimately settled out of court later that year on November 1st, 1949, by mutual agreement between the two publishing companies, with Frank Walker serving as arbitrator. Acuff Rose and Mills would share the publishing on Hank's recording of the song, each collecting 5/8 of a cent from MGM in recognition of the promotional work that Acuff Rose had done on the song's behalf. Mills would retain 100% of all other rights to the song. While all this publishing mess was going on in the background, the song took a roller coaster ride on the charts during the month of April as more artists started recording and releasing their own versions of Lovesick Blues. On April 16th, Hank's version dropped from number 3 to number 6. The following week, it rose back up and claimed the number 2 spot, still failing to knock Eddie Arnold out at number 1. That week, Red Kirk released a version of the song. The following week, Hank's version fell back down to number 4 when yet another version of Lovesick Blues was released, this time by a band named Rusty Gilbert and the Louisiana Swing Boys. Hank's version managed to recover and reclaim the number 2 spot the following week. A third version of Lovesick Blues was also released that month by a band called Ben Christian and His Texas Cowboys, as well as another one by an artist named Eddie Crosby. Then, finally, on May 21st, 1949, there it was. Hank Williams was on top of the charts for the first time, with Lovesick Blues coming in at number 1. Lovesick Blues would ultimately go on to hold the number 1 spot for 16 weeks. It gave Hank his nickname, the Lovesick Blues Boy, a name that would follow him for the remaining 3 years of his life. Not even a song from his own pen would ever eclipse the success he had found with Lovesick Blues. Now it wasn't a question of if he would ever play the Grand Ole Opry, it was a question of when. Oscar Davis was manager and promoter for some of the biggest country stars in the 1930s and 40s. Originally from Rhode Island, he found himself in the country music business after spending time working in vaudeville and motion picture promotion. One of his artists was Ernest Tubb, and that's more than likely where Hank Williams got his phone number. Before he had even recorded Lovesick Blues, Hank had called Oscar and told him, "Now I'm ready for you. Now you'll want me." Hank told him about Lovesick Blues, saying, "I do this number, Oscar, and so help me God, I get 14, 15 encores." "He played me Lovesick Blues," Oscar Davis said, "and in my mind I said, this is the most horrible goddamn thing I've heard in all my life." Hank promised Oscar 25% for life if he could get him on the Grand Ole Opry. Davis told Hank that he didn't have to do that, but said he would find a way to get him on the show somehow. Davis signed Hank to a personal management contract and contacted artist services manager Jim Denny at the Opry about having Hank on the show. "No, we won't have him," Denny said. "He's got a bad reputation for drinking and missing shows." After pleading with Denny and promising that Hank would stay sober for 1 year, Denny finally agreed to square it away, as Davis put it. He also managed to book Hank on an Opry tour in June that would take him through Texas, Oklahoma, and Louisiana with a cast of Opry stars. There were also rumors that Opry management was not only concerned about Hank's reputation for drinking and missing shows, but also wary of signing him due to other Opry stars coming back from tours where Hank had appeared with them and recounting how Hank had stolen the show and upstaged the stars. Meanwhile, Fred Rose was busy working behind the scenes. Playing every card he could, he reportedly gave Harry Stone and Jack Stapp songwriting credits on a song he had just written called "Chattanooga Shoeshine Boy." Stone being the Opry manager at the time and Stapp the program director for WSM. In exchange, Fred Rose was able to secure a spot on the Opry for Hank and an early morning show on WSM. Meanwhile, back in Shreveport, Hank knew success was right around the corner. For that reason, he bought a new car, a 7-seat 1948 Packard limousine touring car. He took over payments from Ernest Tubbs' guitar player, and just like it had done for the Texas Troubadours, it would provide first-class transportation for Hank Williams and the Drifting Cowboys for the busy months ahead. In another deal brokered by Fred Rose, Frank Walker, the head of MGM Records, tore up Hank's original contract and gave him a brand new one. For 2 years and with a higher royalty rate, Hank would go from making 3 cents on every record sold to five, both as an artist and songwriter. In the middle of all this, on Thursday, May 26, 1949, Hank Williams Jr. was born at the North Louisiana Sanitarium Hospital in Shreveport. With the big check still on the horizon from Acuff Rose and MGM, Hank had to borrow $100 from the owner of the Bantam Grill in Shreveport to pay the hospital bill. At 3:45 a.m. the following morning, Hank wired Fred Rose in Nashville with a message saying, "10-pound boy born this morning at 1:45, both doing fine." Hank made his farewell appearance on the hayride on June 3, 1949, before a standing-room-only crowd of 3,800. The performance was billed as Hank's last hayride appearance, so needless to say, it sold out almost immediately. When Hank went on last at 10:30 p.m., he carried a stack of telegrams on stage with him. He stepped up to the mic, cocked his hat back, and started reading off the requests one by one. He would read one and then toss it aside, read another and toss it aside. He finally stopped reading them and just tossed the remaining stack and said, "Let her go, boys," and played nothing but Lovesick Blues until sign-off. The people kept hollering for encore after encore until Hank had finally performed the song about 7 times. "Thank you," Hank finally said once the crowd had quieted down enough so that he could be heard. "I want to thank you all from the bottom of my heart, and I'm making you a promise right now. One of these days, I'll be back." Following the performance, Hank disbanded the hayride iteration of the Drifting Cowboys, telling them backstage that he was leaving for Texas in the morning and said, "If I call you, you have a job, and if I don't, you don't." None of them got a call. Hank left that next morning on a tour that would take him to Houston, Amarillo, Oklahoma City, Dallas, and New Orleans with Ernest Tubb, Red Foley, Cowboy Copas, Minnie Pearl, and Rod Brasfield. Hank had met most of these artists before as an opening act when they would come through Montgomery or some other nearby city in Alabama, but this was the first time he shared a bill with them as a star, and in the Louisiana Bayou country where Hank had spent the last year on air on KWKH, he was just as popular, if not more popular, than any of these Opry stars. Minnie Pearl would recall of Hank on this tour many years later that he had a wonderful wardrobe and a clean hat and shiny boots. He looked great. Watching him perform for the first time, she recalled, an excitement seemed to spread through the crowd. By the time he got to his last number, the excitement had grown to a fever pitch. The crowd would not let him leave the stage. After umpteen encores, they finally got Hank off and me on. It was not one of my better shows. They still wanted more of Hank, and I didn't blame them. The man had something indefinable, something that made an audience crave more. I told Oscar after the show, and every other promoter after that, never put me on after Hank Williams, and I never followed him again. On the morning of June 10th, Hank loaded up the Packard limousine and pulled out of Shreveport with a 12-hour, 600-mile drive ahead of him to get to Nashville to make his Opry appearance the next night. Audrey, Lucretia, and a two-week-old Hank Williams Jr. would stay behind until Hank could find a house. When Hank arrived in Nashville late that night, he checked into his room at the Hermitage Hotel on Union Street, just a few blocks from the WSM studios. It was the most luxurious hotel in Nashville and where all Opry guests stayed. The next day, he went to WSM Studios and had his first publicity photos taken. At this point, Lovesick Blues had been number one on the charts for 5 weeks, and Wedding Bells was steadily rising right behind it, sitting at number nine on that particular night. 3,574 people waited out in the humid summer heat on the evening of June 11, 1949 to get into the Ryman Auditorium to see the Grand Ole Opry. Tickets were 60 cents for reserve seats and 30 cents for general admission. The wooden pews were full of country music fans fanning themselves with Opry-branded hand fans that were sold as souvenirs just as much as they were a way to make the evening inside the unventilated building more tolerable. And while it may be hard for us to imagine now, very few of these people even knew who Hank Williams was. He was just scheduled to be a guest performer on the non-network portion of the Opry that night. Outside the Ryman, fans waited in a line that stretched up Fifth Avenue in a carnival-like atmosphere where hawkers sold everything from these cardboard fans to Opry programs and other souvenirs. Inside the Ryman, musicians and stagehands went back and forth setting up their instruments and radio equipment for that night's broadcast. Behind them hung a huge vinyl banner that displayed the name and logo of the advertiser sponsoring each segment of the show. Every 15 to 30 minutes, a new banner would come down and serve as a stage backdrop for that portion of the show. Then, at 7:30 p.m., the show began with the American Ace Coffee segment.
It's Grand Ole Opry time!
Howdy, all your friends and neighbors!
Roy Acuff got things started that night with his song, Low and Lonely.
Low and lonely, sad and blue, thinking only of little you, always trying to keep from crying, I'm low and lonely.
This was followed by Uncle Dave Macon performing Take Me Back to My Carolina Home, along with performances of a dozen or so other artists that time has pretty much forgotten. At 8 p.m., the Purina segment kicked off with Cowboy Copas and Dolly Dear, followed by George Morgan with Candy Kisses.
Candy kisses, wrapped in paper, mean more to you than any of mine. Candy.
The 8:30 segment was prime time for the Grand Ole Opry. The Prince Albert Smoking Tobacco segment, hosted by Red Foley, who kicked things off with the Tennessee Polka.
Every Saturday night, they do a barn dance upright to the Tennessee Polka.
Jimmy Wakely, who was a cowboy movie star and singer, was a featured guest that night and performed Someday You'll Call My Name and I Won't Answer. At 9 o'clock, the R.C. Cola segment, hosted by Roy Acuff, kicked off, featuring that night comedians Jam Up and Honey, Lonzo and Oscar, and Little Jimmy Dickens.
My mama always said to me, Jim, take a tater and wait.
Now taters never did taste good with chicken on the plate, but I had to eat them just the same.
At 9:30 p.m., the Warren Paint Show kicked off. This segment was hosted by Ernest Tubb, and he kicked off with his current hit single, Biting My Fingernails and Thinking of You.
You really got me worried now, I must confess it's true. I sit around twiddling my thumbs, breaking my heart in two. I'm wondering if you love me so the way you say you do. I'm biting my fingernails and thinking dear of you.
Then Ernest Tubb introduced Hank Williams. He walked out on stage wearing a white suit and cowboy hat to polite, muted applause as there was no real name recognition. The band kicked off Lovesick Blues, and as he sang the opening line and hit that first yodel, the place absolutely exploded. The audience rose as one with a delighted roar as Hank's vocals were lost amidst a sea of cheer and applause. They knew the song, but they didn't know the singer. But after that night, the name Hank Williams and country music would be synonymous. The band that backed Hank Williams on this Opry debut would include legendary musicians such as Zeb Turner, Billy Robinson, Grady Martin, Jimmy Self, Ernie Newton, and Jimmy Riddle. As Hank finished the song, the audience continued to cheer and applaud as one of the events that created the Hank Williams legend unfolded. When Ernest Tubb was unable to quiet the crowd, Hank returned to the microphone and performed the song, or at least part of it, again. The audience still hadn't had enough of the Lovesick Blues Boy. To the best of anyone's recollection, he came back and encored the song anywhere from 3 to 6 times, but most people who were there seemed to agree on the number being 3 encores. It was something that hadn't happened on the Opry before, and 70 years later, it hasn't happened since. Hank returned to the stage later that night during the 11 p.m. to 11:30 p.m. Allen Manufacturing Company segment and followed George Morgan with a performance of Mind Your Own Business. Lovesick Blues would go on to be named the top country and western record of the year by Billboard magazine, best hillbilly record of the year by Cashbox magazine, and landed at number 24 on the most played jukebox records of 1949 list. Hank Williams was named number 2 on the list of 1949's top-selling folk artists, just behind Eddie Arnold. In 2004, Hank's recording of Lovesick Blues was added to the United States National Recording Registry by the Library of Congress. The song would reemerge many times over the years, being recorded by artists such as Patsy Cline, Marty Robbins, Jerry Lee Lewis, The Ventures, Etta James, Leon Redbone, Little Richard, Merle Haggard, Carl Perkins, George Strait, and many, many more. Lovesick Blues recently re-entered the pop culture world of 2018 when an internet video of Mason Ramsey, also known as the Yodeling Walmart Kid, had a video go viral on YouTube of him performing the song at a Walmart in Illinois. Ramsey's performance sparked new interest in Hank Williams' recording of the song, and in March, Rolling Stone reported that Spotify's Viral 50 chart for the U.S. ranked Hank Williams' Lovesick Blues at number 3 and number 4 around the globe. And so that's about it, folks. That's the long and twisting road of Lovesick Blues from 1922 up until 1949, when Hank Williams became the first person to ever have any luck recording the song. I had a lot of fun making this and researching it and learned quite a few things myself that I didn't know and some things I thought I knew that I didn't know. So I hope you guys enjoyed it as well, and we'll be making some more of these down the road. I did interview Billy Robinson for this project, who backed Hank Williams on steel guitar that night on the Grand Ole Opry. And in a couple weeks, we're going to do a supplemental episode of Honky Tonk History that'll feature that interview. And so you can learn a little bit about Billy, his career, some of the people he worked with, and some of his memories of June 11th, 1949. So that's about it, folks. I'm going to sign off here and get ready to do another one of these. And I'd love to get your feedback. Like I said, this is the first time I've done anything like this, so I'm going to be learning as I go. But I hope we did okay, and I hope you guys enjoyed it, and we'll see you next time. So long.